This conference will now be recorded.
Hello, good morning, students.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Harika is just arrived. Are you Harika or Ayesha? Hello? Harika is there? Ayesha is there?
Yes, sir.
In the last class, we were discussing about correlation. So you all know that there are two types of effusions. One is X-ray, the other one is cancer rate. X-ray is due to like the various number of causes are there. There again, pleural effusion, right side and left side. What are the causes of left side effusion, Ayesha? Causes of left side effusion. There are some specific causes.
Pancreatitis.
Very good.
Heart failure.
Trauma. Yes, very good. Trauma. Usually effusion occurs, of course, in some cases like heart failure, renal failure on both sides. But in some cases, only left-sided effusion will occur. They are, one is, as you said, pancreatitis.
Lung abscess rupture.
Rupture of lung abscess, of course, both it may present, but specific causes are there. They are, one is pancreatitis. The second one is esophagus, rupture of esophagus, and then thoracic duct, trauma to the thoracic duct, and the pericarditis. They are common, they are more common on the left side. Of course, right side, of other, all other causes may be on the right and left, but here special circumstances where you find if you on the left side. And again, I told you that the treatment like hydrothorax, the renal failure, and cirrhosis of liver, there the treatment is only just giving diuretics. So if you do diuretics, the effusion will disappear. Effusion will disappear because of, you said, you know that there are so many causes of hydrothorax or effusion because of increased hydrostatic, low albumin content like that. So just in giving albumin, give a proteinase right, then giving diuretics, this effusion will disappear. But their effusion, that the tissue permeability being like in case of pleural effusion because of pneumonia, lung abscess, bronchitis, there you have to use antibiotics and other things. So that is one. And again, important things are effusion may be due to various causes like connective tissue disorders like rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, there also the effusion will be there. And again, you have to measure the glucose level. Glucose level, of course, Light's criteria you know very well. Light's criteria, you have to differentiate between X-ray and transplant. Of course, that's different. But here, in the pleural effusion, maybe due to some reason or maybe due to hydrothorax, then you can give treatment like diuretics and antibiotics like that. But sometimes when the you have to also estimate the pH of the issue. The pH, and the second one is the glucose level. When the glucose level is less than 60, maybe a cause, maybe due to like this rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, like that. So there, the glucose level will be very, very less. In emphysema. So there you have to use only tube thoracostomy. Tube thoracostomy is the treatment of choice. The second one is the pH level. pH usually it will be more than 7.3. So when it is less than 7.1, then again you have to use tube thoracostomy. So tube thoracostomy. So just so three types of treatment. One is conservative treatment, giving diuretics and antibiotics. The second one is tube thoracostomy. Tube thoracostomy that is, and again underwater level, underwater scene, treatment that you have to do, you have to give. The precautions you have to take, then three-way, like that, so that you will prevent hydronovotharyngitis. The second one is if there is recurrent effusion, like in case of malignancies, and in some cases where a lot of collection is there because of various reasons, there at actually you can obliterate the pleural cavity. Obliterate the pleural cavity by injecting tetracyclines or by injecting a talc. So that will you obliterate the pulmonary, that is, sorry, the pleural cavity, so that the effusion will not occur. So that is about pleural effusion. So pleural effusion, I told you, the various types of pleural effusion, hydrothorax and pleural effusion, right side and left side pleural effusion, and LSSR in case of moderate side pleural effusion, and all those things are very, very important. The next topic I'm going to take today is tuberculosis. Tuberculosis is a big subject. I may take two or three classes. So what is tuberculosis? Tuberculosis is, what is tuberculosis? Tuberculosis is kshaya. Kshaya means phthisis. You know, and actually this was known as phthisis. Phthisis means destruction of the lung. Phthisis is the destruction. Phthisis is destruction. Actually it was known about 70-80 years back as phthisis pulmonalis. Phthisis pulmonalis is the destruction of the lung. Of course, in ancient India also, we knew that it is known by a name kshaya. So, phthisis is destruction. About the patient loses his weight. Patient is loses weight. Emaciated. Phthisis means emaciation. Destruction of the lung. The patient is emaciated. Bones are out. Intercostal muscles are drained out. So the patient will, looks like emaciated, thinned out, only bones will be there. So that's why it was known as phthisis pulmonalis about 78 years back. Now also some people call it phthisis. Phthisis means just worn out or just destruction of the lung. Tuberculosis, it has been there for number of years. For centuries, that is prevalent. This is prevalent in Europe and America also. In Europe and America, this has been there. This has been there for a long time, for centuries together. In 18th, 19th century, Europe is prevalent, and of course, India is also there. But Europe, in America and other countries, they are able to control pulmonary tuberculosis. They are able to control, but of course, India is still lagging behind. It's still lagging because of so many reasons. So the history, if we go, Linnaeus actually auscultated tuberculosis patient also, and actually he was also one of the pioneers. To give findings of the respiratory system, like whispering pectoral lung. Whispering pectoral lung is found by Linnaeus. Joseph Rene Linnaeus, he invented the stethoscope. So actually, he died of tuberculosis. Very young, early age. Linnaeus died, I think, around the age of 45 years. He died because of tuberculosis. Actually, he was one of the pioneers who invented the stethoscope and actually auscultated the lung about whispering pectoral lung and crackles like that it is described. So that is about something about history. Coming to tuberculosis proper, of course, it's a leading cause of death. Even now, because after about, again, Western countries were able to control tuberculosis for some years. Again, after the outbreak of 1981, HIV, again in Europe and in America, then tuberculosis cases are rising. But of course, in India, about 1/4 of the total world cases, one fourth of cases actually, they are present in India. So deaths are also say more or less over 1/4 to 1/5 million deaths. So of course, throughout the world, is generate about 1 million throughout the world. Totally ancient disease, of course, spinal tuberculosis present in mummies, Egyptian mummies, dates about 1552 1080 BC, identified with PCR. Robert Koch actually discovered mycobacterium tuberculosis in 1882. Of course, many people have been affected during those days. We must be knowing for an important fight as John Keats. John Keats fight is one. He died of tuberculosis. He died of very young age. Died of tuberculosis those days. So those days only the Robert Koch and other they so much of research and actually they identified this species tuberculosis. So again the tuberculosis bacilli, there so many varieties of bacilli are here. But we are interested in actually human TB. Human TB is caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis humanis, actually, that is Mycobacterium tuberculosis humanis. And of course, this bovine tuberculosis is very common in America. America, they most of them drink unpasteurized milk, the bovis, Mycobacterium tuberculosis bovis. And the third one important is actually Mycobacterium avium. Mycobacterium causes atypical bacteria, usually occurs in immunodeficient individuals like HIV patients. Like the avian, the common is actually these three. Mycobacterium tuberculosis humanis is caused infection case of humans. And lungs, the lungs are commonly involved. Bovis, of course, also Mycobacterium tuberculosis bovis also infect the humans. But usually the intestine, you should know the primary regions where the tuberculosis infects. There are one is actual lungs, pulmonary tuberculosis by humanis. The other one is lymph nodes. Lymph nodes like the patient affects actually milk and all those things. Bovis is one cause and actually this humanis is also another cause. And the third one is the primary regions, one is lungs, one is in the tonsil, and the third one is gastrointestinal tract. The gastrointestinal tract, it may be due to unpasteurized Mycobacterium bovis, or it may be the lung tuberculosis, actually the patient is coughing. Sometimes the phlegm actually, sometimes the patient swallow the cough material and enters into the lung, intestine. So it may enter intestine. So lungs, tonsils, and intestine and the primary areas where the tuberculosis is first. So of course the other bacteria, so many mycobacteria causing skin ulcerans, atypical bacteria like protostomogens, so many are, and then saprophytic bacteria are there. Mycobacterium, Butyricum, Stercoralis, and of course, non-contagious bacilli. So, one important feature about Mycobacterium tuberculosis is very slow growing bacteria compared to so many other bacteria. They grow very few hours, they divide in very few hours and multiply very fast. But Mycobacterium tuberculosis takes about 18 to 20 hours to multiply, slow growing, of course, hydrophobic, clump together means just like the rods, they are acid fast rods, they are like routine stains, actually you cannot stain with gram stain. Then what did the stain, that is the mycobacteria, what is the stain? Somebody, one of you, please tell. What is the staining technique? Which stain you will use?
Jean Nelson.
Deaden stain, very good. Jean Nelson's technique, or card ball pushing, Jean Nelson stain is used because it's not stained with grams. Acid cause bacillus. Unusual stain, like not stained by gram stain. Only Jean Nelson's stain is used. Of course, the stain, if you actually look into the anatomy of the clerical bacillus, it's complex. Complex cell wall. It has got a very complex cell wall lipid. Cell will be there so much, very, very complex. So that's why it's very, very difficult to kill the bacteria. Not one antibiotic is sufficient. There are four antibiotics are required in the bacillus because of the complexity of the cell wall and the pathogenicity. So coming to the predisposing factors, of course, you know very well. Malnutrition or clotting, drugs. And they're smoking, alcoholism, diabetes, corticosteroids. People who are taking corticosteroids for the indication, which is also there. So they are all predisposing factors to get mycobacterial tuberculosis. Of course, the pathogenesis is very, very important. Pathogenesis is very, very important because it's not actually simple, it's a very, very complicated. Of course, it is caused by droplet nuclei. The pathogen, the root of infection is through droplet nuclei. The droplets will contain multiple bacteria. Multiple, these rod-shaped bacteria will be there in one droplet. So you should know one thing, the patient coughs, the 1 ml of sputum will contain, 10,000 to 50,000 bacilli. 10,000 to 50,000 bacilli. So, the patient coughs, at least you will cough will more than 3 to 5 ml, sometimes maybe there. So, imagine there may be 30,000 to 150,000 bacilli may be there. So, it is simple, just one bacillus is just enough to infect the individual. You know, one cavity in the mycobacterium tuberculosis cavity is there. How many bacilli will be there? One cavity will contain one cavity. You know, cavity formation is there. One cavity, one of you. He tells some answer, nothing wrong. One cavity contains how many bacteria, madam? Ayesha, Harika.
So in thousands.
what is more important is in the primary tuberculosis, whenever the patient gets infected for the first time, the macrophages, actually when it enters into the lungs, it will go into the actually pleural, subpleural process. It will go into deep to the blast, because in every actually lobe, upper lobe, middle lobe, lower lobe, the so many bronchi, bronchioles are there. It will go into blast, into the alveoli and reach the subpleural focus. Subpleural is just above the pleura. Just above the pleura it will reach. There, it will engulf by the macrophage, alveolar macrophage. The alveolar macrophages will actually engulf the tuberculous bacteria. Tuberculous bacteria that comes in is droplets. So there actually there's so many factors release, so much of activity will be there in the macrophages will be there. So what happens ultimately, the one macro, when it is engulfed for the macrophages also we will be fighting, and sometimes some tuberculosis bacteria will be released from the macrophages, and other macrophages will also there join together, will also join together. So one important thing is that manipulation. This bacteria has got one important feature, is it manipulates in the macrophages and growth. So it's not easily conquered by the macrophages. Of course, in some cases actually they lay dormant, but some individuals actually, because of their manipulation, very severity of their tuberculosis bacteria, sometimes of course it progresses. But what happens, other macrophages will also join together. Other macrophages along with the bacteria, sometimes they're able to kill. But what happens? In about 90% of individuals, the infection will lie dormant. In individuals. All of us would have got infected by Mycobacterium tuberculosis. All of us would have this complex, primary complex or Bones complex. So these all macrophages unite, and they'll form actually this. They're known as a granuloma. The granuloma will be there, they will be mostly at the peripheries, it will be there. In 90% of individuals, they will lie dormant. The bacteria may be live or dead in the granuloma. So, but what happens, it causes cheesy material. The nature of tuberculosis is wherever it goes, where it may be in the brain or it may be in the skin. Or it may be the liver, or it may be anywhere in the body, the central part of the granuloma will be necrosed. It will try to destroy the central part. That is known as caseous necrosis. So here also necrosis of course will be there. And that will actually die down. And of course if you take X-ray after some time, then actually that will be just like a nodule will be there. The granuloma is actually like this. But sometimes what happens, that is known as Gons focus, H-O-N, Gons focus. That is known as Gons focus. In Gons focus, sometimes what happens is that the macrophages will take the bacteria along with it to the nearby lymph nodes. And actually they will be handed over to the lymphocyte there, T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes. Of course, they will all try to fight there. So these all become actually Gons complex. The Gons complex will be there. Gons focus along with the regional lymph nodes, that is paratracheal lymph nodes. Paratracheal lymph nodes. That is known as Gons complex. Gons complex also, it may be arrested there. May be arrested in 90% of individuals, that may be arrested there. So you have a Gons focus or Gons complex that lie dormant there. But only 10% of the individuals, the reactivation will occur. The dissemination or reactivation, whatever you call it, they will occur only in 10%. Only 5% immediately it may occur. Another 5% it may occur after so many years, after so many months, or so many years. So that is the fate of this tubercular bacilli in the body. So 90% individuals that will be there, just like the Gons focus or a Gons complex, that will be there. And only in 10% of the individuals, then this will occur, the dissemination or progress will occur. So this is primary, post-primary, this we are given here. Initial response, bacilli angles, alveolar macrophages, multiply and durate subfloral focus, and the lower part of the Gons focus, primary complex. The patient will hear this far, infected area will be there. Few viable bacilli may remain in the lung. Bacteria this time go dormant state as long as that's the immune system remains active and functional normally. Deactivation will occur. About 5% of the individual deactivation will occur. You must know three types of diagnosis in an individual. Basically, this you must know one thing. There are three types of diagnosis in case of tuberculosis. What are they? One is a primary complex. Primary complex you must know. And the secondary primary disease and the secondary disease. And again, you must know the disease is manifesting as three varieties. What are they? One is the primary complex may progress. Restored, yes. Hello. Are you able to hear now? Hello. Hello,
yes,
students.
Sir.
Are you able to hear now?
Yes, sir.
Somebody must respond.
Yes, sir.
Yes. You must tell me that you are not able to hear. Okay. Come on. Coming to the tuberculosis, three types of diagnosis will be there. Our primary, secondary, leave it. Three types of diagnosis will be there. You have to put whenever you get a patient of tuberculosis. That is one is progressive primary tuberculosis. Progressive primary tuberculosis. That is one. The second one is post primary tuberculosis. Progressive primary tuberculosis, where actually the primary complex itself progresses because of various reasons. The second one is what you see day in and day out in our wards is post-primary tuberculosis. After the primary complex is there, it has been there. Because of various reasons, it has been deactivated. It has been deactivated. Then it is known as post-primary tuberculosis. After it may take many years or it may take many months. So when the individual's immunity is actually compromised, then the reactivation occurs. That is post-primary tuberculosis. Again, after the post-primary tuberculosis, when it is being treated or when it is not being treated properly, like in case of relapse or in case of failure, that is known as post tuberculosis, the patient may present with one of these complications. The patient may present with one of these complications like The patient may present initially, the patient has tuberculosis not treated. After about 2 or 3 years, again the patient will come with the same symptom like relapse. So this is known as post. The patient may come with one of these diseases. The patient may come with pneumonia, tuberculosis pneumonia. The patient may present with cavity with fibrosis. The patient may present with pleural effusion. The patient may present with bronchiectasis. So like that, the manifestation will occur when the patient has developed tuberculosis, being treated properly or improperly, and again the patient, so that is known as post-tuberculosis pneumonia. Post-tuberculosis bronchiectasis. Post-tuberculosis pneumonia. Like that. So three types of diagnosis you have to put. If you find a young individual, young child, then that is progressive primary complex, progresses. The second, young adult, if you find that he may be a post-primary tuberculosis, and about old age, or about more, roughly around 50 years, if you find a patient with complication, that this patient is already suffered from tuberculosis, now he has coming with complication, like post-tuberculosis pneumonia. It may be due to tuberculosis only, pneumonia. Bronchitis may be tuberculosis. Otherwise, pneumonia may be pneumococcal. Or bronchitis may be bacteria. Or pleural effusion may be some other reason. Or and cavity may, of course, it may be aspergillus like that. But if you find a patient like that, it may be due to only tuberculosis. So, three types of diagnosis you must know. Coming to the reactivate here, and the person's immune system depressed, secondary reactive factor. So in the progress, what happens? Beta primary complex is heals, no progression, heals with fibrosis and calcification. Bones complex are undergoing progressive fibrosis and radiolysis. It is known as Ranke complex. Of course, it is known as Ranke complex. And the progress is, this I told you just now, the progress, sometimes the primary tuberculosis may disseminate to organs like liver, spleen, and kidney. So why it progresses in some individuals and in some children? Because of various reasons. What are the various reasons? Like the patient's nourishment is not good. The patient's nourishment is not good. And the patient, the child actually has been given corticosteroids. The patient has developed leukemia. The patient has developed some type of cancer. And of course, some other causes which actually decrease the immunity, like in case of IDD, the type 1 diabetes mellitus there. It may progress. The primary complex may progress. That is known as progressive primary complex. And it may reactivate. Reactivation will occur or it progresses in various ways. What are the various ways? It can produce meningitis. The brain is involved. Miliary tuberculosis. It may cause miliary tuberculosis in the lungs. It may cause the tuberculosis in the liver, and it may go to the bone, it may go to skin, anywhere, it may disseminate, it may go to brain, it may go to heart, liver, kidney, everywhere, anywhere it may go and cause actually disseminated tuberculosis. That is known as progressive primary tuberculosis there. For dissemination to organs like liver, spleen, kidney, etc. Multiple gray association, multiple wherever there is tuberculosis, I told you, wherever there is tuberculosis, the characteristic feature of tuberculosis is central caseation. It may be in the skin, or it may be in the brain, or it may be in the kidney, it may be in the liver, wherever it is. The feature is central caseation. Central caseation will occur and it will cause, of for education. I told you in some actually clinics actually, then suppose if it is in the lymph nodes. Lymph nodes, what happens? What is the progress in the case of lymph node? In case of first lymph nodes may get infected. Initially, the lymph node may get infected. Like in case of tonsil are there, the lymph node may get infected. What happens? What happens, Amma? What is the progression of the disease in case of lymph nodes? First, the lymph nodes are discrete and painful. Then after some time, unlike other cases, actually they all unite together. That is known as they're all uniting together. Lymph nodes, they're all uniting together. What do you call it? One of you, please. Matting. That is known as matting of the lymph nodes. First initial discrete matting. After matting, it will form just like a lump or swelling. So wherever there is swelling, and actually I told you the feature is the central caseation. So when that is the material is liquid material will be there in the center of the swelling. So wherever there is liquid in the body, that is maybe in the brain, in the skin, subcutaneous tissue, kidneys, the feature is it will come out. The central caseous necrotic material or abscess, whatever it is, that will try to come out. That is known as polar state abscess. So if you take the cervical lymph node, that will be polar state abscess. The polar state abscess, actually abscess is there, it tries to rupture. So it will form a sinus. So that is the fate of lymph nodes in the cervical region. One is they are discrete, and then matting, polar state abscess, caseation to caseation, polar state abscess, and sinus formation. So just like that, here of course, here it is shown, caseation is there, central caseation is there, multiple areas of softening and softening will be there. Cavity formation. So this is secondary pulmonary tuberculosis. It may occur in the progressive primary tuberculosis. The central case is cavity formation. Surprisingly, we find without any much symptomatology, patient may present with upper lobe cavity formation, that is in primary complex. The progressive primary complex actually will find a cavity in upper lobe. And of course, secondary pulmonary tuberculosis, that is also very, very common. And the post-tuberculosis cavity formation also, I told. Fate of secondary tuberculosis. The lesion may heal fibrosis, scarring, and calcification. The lesion may coalesce together, form a large area tuberculosis pneumonia. It may produce a pulmonary extrapulmonary. The tuberculosis caseous pneumonia, fibrocaseous tuberculosis, miliary tuberculosis. I told you this may occur in the primary tuberculosis also, and this may occur in the secondary tuberculosis also. Of course, miliary tuberculosis extends infection through hepatogenous tract. They are very small, 2 millimeters of size, yellow white, scattered throughout the lung parenchyma. And can cause pleural effusion, empyema, pleuritis. Extrapulmonary miliary tuberculosis also may be there. Like it may occur in the liver, spleen, bone, anywhere actually they may disseminate to the blood vessels. This is actually fallopian tube separated means then you know. Well, actually, clinically. What are the external markers of tuberculosis? External markers of tuberculosis are this is actually epididymis. Even what are they? In the skin, they may be tuberculocinia versicola, Leberbach vulgaris, erythema nodal, and epididymo arthritis. Kidney dermatitis is also maybe a manifestation of tuberculosis. They are external markers of tuberculosis, of course. Of course, ectopulmonary tuberculosis may occur hematogenous spread. It may go into the intestine, or it may go into the meninges. It may cause tuberculous meningitis. The various tuberculosis we are describing, because tuberculosis is a very, very big topic, very, very big topic. It may take our 2 or 3 classes. It may go to the brain, it may go to bones, it may go to parts, it may go to vertebrae, it is known as part spine, fallopian tube. Our lymph nodes may get involved. So you must know three types of diseases, three types of diagnosis. One is progressive primary disease, or progressive primary complex. The second one is post-primary tuberculosis, that is what we see day in and day out in the wards. The third one is also you will find in the wards. Of course, primary complex you will find in actual pediatrics ward, pediatrics. The third one is actually also a complication. Complication post tuberculosis, pneumonia, bronchiectasis, like that. So, what are the clinical features? What are the clinical features? The clinical features are actually there may not be very good important symptoms in the initial stage. The patient may have cough for about 2 or 3 weeks. The patient may have only fever. And what is when does the patient will get fever? The patient will get fever in the evening time. Evening time means the patient may get fever, just a little fever, that is about 99 degrees or not more than 100. 100 or sometimes. So the patient will have evening rise of temperature between 7 and 10. 7 and 9 like that. It's night sweats. Patient will have only night sweats. Light fever. Fever is actually the disappearance of fever with the temperature with the night sweats. And of course, little cough may be there. Cough may be there. And the patient sometimes may develop loss of appetite. Weight loss also may be there. Sometimes in some individuals only you will find, if you examine the patient, you will hear wheezes and crackles, but the localized wheeze or crackles. Sometimes occasionally you say that is right. And lymphadenopathy may be there. Lymphadenopathy may be there, like in case of actually children, usually it has an occur. I told you, it may be tonsils or what is primary complex, paracycle may be there. And that is parenchymal lesion, Gans focus. Gans focus is, I told you, that is peripheral Gans focus, let's see, that is peripheral focus, that is peripheral focus. And of course, Gans complexes, both lymph nodes and the Gans nodes. But chloroleptic fusion, he says about 30 to 40% of the cases may be also there, in primary tuberculosis. So what are other clinical features? Usually other clinical features are actually because of the disease that is present in individuals. So the patient may present with, I told you, it may post primary tuberculosis. It may dissemination occur. The patient may present with pleural effusion. So what are the clinical features? I told you in the last pleural effusion, the patient may present with fever. The patient may present with chest pain. The patient may present with breathlessness. The patient may present with cough. Like that, depending upon pleural effusion, may present. Of course, because of the pleural effusion, extra tracheal deviation, pleural dull percussion, all those things will be there. Suppose the patient develops pneumonia at consolidation, at the consolidation, what do you get? The patient will get actually, suppose VF and VR increase, dull per dull load and percussion. And then if you auscultate, you will hear a bronchial failure. Sometimes you will hear tracheals. So like that, depending upon the manifestation, the patient may present. Suppose if it is the lymph node, I told you the lymph node progress like the various four stages, hatching, swelling, like that. So like that, depending upon the manifestation, the patient, of course, paratracheal, sometimes the patient may present with hoarseness of voice. The patient may present with actually difficulty in breathing. Like, depending upon the presentation, of course, prolapsation, I just told you. So the clinical features may be because of the disease that is the patient had, because of consolidation, because of the cavity, or because of the pleural effusion, or because of the bronchiectasis. So like that, depending upon the manifestation of the disease, the patient will have so many symptoms. Otherwise, initially in the primary complex, the patient may not be having any symptoms. The patient may be the child or a 10 years, 12 years, or 14, 15 years, or just a young adult, maybe just having only just evening rise of temperature. Evening rise of temperature and sometimes cough, and sometimes the patient only sets, if you ask the patient, only and have night sweats and some loss of memory. That's all. No wheezes, no crackles, and not many manifestations may be there. So if the patient may be present like that in case of primary complex, you may not be able to detect. But in case of secondary tuberculosis, various post-primary tuberculosis and post-tuberculosis, they manifest. There, of course, the cavity is there. The patient may present with a lot of sputum. Sometimes the patient may present with hemoptysis. The patient may present with hemoptysis. So like that, depending upon the manifestation, then the patient will have symptoms. Of course, the different diagnosis, TB, hematoma, malignancy, adversity. These are the advanced complex, calcified hilar lymph nodes. Calcified hilar lymph nodes. TB. Lymph nodes may be due to lymph nodes. Of course, TB, sarcoid also, bronchial also, lymphoma, metastasis. Gone complex. For the treatment of the diagnosis, I'll take up in the next class. So what is more important is sarcoidosis, bilateral lymph nodes may be there. The hyla, this is known as hyla. This is both hyla region. This of course is. This is where both right and left carina may be there. Like this. This is hyla. This is. What is this? Is water the right? What are the heart? This is the left water. Superior vena cava. This is right here. This is the aorta. Pulmonary bay. Left atrial left leg. This is the left leg. This is the hilar region. What you are doing is you are finding these knots. This is Gons complex. Paratracheal hemorrhagic analysis. It also means what is there. So this here it is. Thank you so much. This is finally done. That is, I'll stop here. I'll continue in the next class. So thank you all. Thank you very much. Thanks for the patient hearing. Thank you. Happy and good. Happy and good. Well, 13 and the. Happy and 40 minutes. Happy and good. Vida and is done. Thank you.